خلق من تراب ثم سواك ثم سي خلقكم من تراب ثم من نطفة ثم سواك رجلا. He's telling you over here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you for a purpose, and there's three things that He's telling you. Are you going to deny that Lord who created you? Which is the physical and biological process and physiological process. The second is, He's telling you who created you for a maqsad. He didn't create this human being here that you had no real input in terms of your creation, in terms of your birth, in terms of your gender, in terms of your name, in terms of your family, nothing. But He created you with a maqsad. And what is that maqsad? What is that goal? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِعَبُدُونَ. Allah created you with a divine purpose. And you want to deny that God who created you. But he wasn't totally atheist. But the point is there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you one very critical point here. He says, even if you theoretically believe in the existence of Allah, and you theoretically believe that God is the creator, cherisher, sustainer, and master of the world, and so on there. But factually, you don't worship Him. Factually, you worship wealth. Factually, you worship everything that is in terms of dunya, acquisition of dunya. Right? Then no matter what you may be doing outwardly, inwardly your goal and your priority is that. And then you are committing shirk. Then you are committing shirk, because what has become your ilah, your deity? Your hawa, your desires have become your deity. Your wealth has become your deity. Name and fame and power has become your deity. Showing off, which is ostentation, riya, which is shirk asghar, hidden shirk, right? Is a form of shirk. All of these things become your deities. These are the things that you worship in the Budkhana, in the temple of. Right? Masha Allah. As Allah has willed. La quwwata illa billah. There is no power except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I constantly say, if God forbid any of you won in the lotto 15 million rand, you'll be overjoyed. Okay, let's use a good example. You inherited 15 million rand from an uncle that you never knew you had. Right? You inherited 15 million rand. Will you sit down and say, what to do, man? Takdeer. Takdeer. Like when someone dies, takdeer. When something bad happens, kya takdeer. Something great happened, 15 million. Yeah, man, takdeer. Masha Allah. As Allah willed. As Allah willed. Do you see this, the will of Allah in action? How Allah is dictating every moment in your life. And how Allah is directing every moment in your life. You know what? It's a fascinating study. How Allah controls your life every day. And the more you tap into it, that Allah is controlling my life every day. I decided to go here. I ended up there. I decided to eat this. I ended up doing that. I decided to buy this. And there's two ways of dealing with it. Either you give priority to what your desires are and you become disgruntled and irritated and frustrated about it. Or you say, Ma sha Allah. La quwwata illa billah. Right, before we end, this is very critical. Right? You know what? MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. Imam Malik radiallahu ta'ala who stated there, he said, right, that whenever a person enters his house, he should at least say, MashaAllah. Right? And a tabi'i, Wahab bin Munabbih, he had written on his house door, outside his house, MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. It is the Quranic antidote. If not only recited, but practically lived and demonstrated and internalized for you to get over the disease of the corruption of the heart, which is caused by lust and desire for wealth and power. Wallah, MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. It should become your mantra. Forgive the word mantra, right? It should become your wazifa. MashaAllah. Yes, ma'am. You want to know something? Okay. Hey, you people don't talk anymore. You know that I'm getting tired of this now. No? MashaAllah. La quwwata illa billah. Now, let me give you this hadith and I will give you. See, the one of the most underrated, right? And most underutilized and most unused du'as or phrases that we kalima that we should be stating is what? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And mashallah, la quwwata illa billah, half of it is la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Mashallah is also a phrase of Allah, mashallah. Most underutilized. Let me give you this hadith. Hazrat Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu, this is Sahih al-Bukhari, right? This is Sunan Abu Dawud, Sunan al-Tirmidhi. Is that okay, Anwari? I've given the references, right? Abu Musa Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala who states that they were one day on a journey, right? And there were a whole lot of the Sahaba kiram that were traveling with the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when they were on a journey, as they would climb up an incline, right? The Sahaba kiram radiallahu alayhi wa sallam would loudly make takbir. Allahu Akbar! Right? So you can imagine, right? There's 1,000 of them. They're, Allahu Akbar! The whole, the valleys and the mountains would, reverberate. With Allahu Akbar. So the Holy Prophet wasallam heard this, these people are shouting and screaming, Allahu Akbar, and each one is trying to outdo the other. So the Holy Prophet wasallam said, be lenient with yourselves, with your souls. Don't exert yourself so much. Because the one that you are calling out to is not deaf. He can hear you, he's all hearing. Right? Right? And he's not absent either, he's present. So why are you screaming so loudly for? Right? And this teaches a lesson as well, right? Do zikr with hosh, not with josh. zikr with hosh, not josh. You understood that? Be present in zikr. Right? Be present in zikr. Right? And don't be... I'm looking for the right word for it. No. Don't be negligent in zikr. Let me explain to you. Many people have this misconception. I want to clarify this thing today. You see, dhikr of Allah, أكثر ذكر الله حتى يقول مجنون. Increase the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to such a degree that people will tell you that you are majnoon. Allah, Rasulullah said, أكثر, meaning increase the amount of zikr. He didn't say the style of zikr. Right? If you and I tell this to all people, I said, don't get carried away, please. If I do this to my head, I'm going to get dizzy. I'm feeling dizzy as it is. So you need to, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, ilallah, 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 and people get hal. Come down, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? What are you working yourself up into a frenzy for? Really, what are you working yourself up in a frenzy for? Sit down quietly. La ilaha illallah. The whole point is you're focusing on Allah. Here you got so caught up. Hey, no, what boss? Hey, the zikr was hot. So what happened? Hey, you know what? I closed my eyes. I could see this nur and anwar and this and this. I said, boss, I'll show you that anwar. I'm making zikr. I said, just mundi yourself, you know, see how you feel dizzy and everything. Really, sometimes, not all the time, not for every person either, right? The euphoria that you feel in the zikr, right? And that, you know, the lightheadedness you feel in the zikr is because of the motions of your head. And I promise you, the day you stop the motions of your head and you just read Allah, 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 you find, oh, okay, nothing happened. The zikr wasn't hot today. Really? Really? Right? There's a rhythm to zikr, I understand that. But, akthiru zikr Allah, Baba. Rasulullah said, increase your amount of zikr. And you get some people, Allah, 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 I get scared. Man, the genuine ones out of that are 0.0.0.1%. They are the exceptions. We made it the rule. For what? For what? You know the number of zikr occasions I've sat in madaris. The guys lean the Allah Allah so fast that my mouth doesn't go so fast. And normally I talk very fast. You can imagine. What's this? I just keep quiet. I just sit down. Can you imagine? I want to know what ruhaniyat you got out of them. And 99% of the time, if they are genuine and true to themselves, when they are taking the name of Allah, they are oblivious to Allah. When they are taking the name of Allah, they are oblivious to Allah. They're taking the name, but they are oblivious to the named. If you were in the presence of the named, then you would maintain respect and adab. I'm in the court of... Can you do that in namaz? Can you do that in namaz? Tell me, can you do that in namaz? So what's wrong with us? Yes, there are certain spiritual points of making La ilaha illallah, like the Prophet Sayyidina Ali Karimullah Ta'ala wajhahu Kareem, to activate the heart. Right, to, and it's a symbolic indication of La, with the, so to speak, you know, that you're clearing your heart of everything other than Allah. It's symbolic there just to reinforce the idea of the dhikr into your head. That becomes the fixation, and we forget. See. Please, man, stop me, man. Go back to La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. We'll talk about all these other problems later on, right? So the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? Says Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala on the other hand, while these people make Allahu Akbar and the Prophet of Allah, you know, calm down a little bit there. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala who states there that he was making dhikr in his heart silently. And he was reading La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. So the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right, reprimanded, so to speak, in inverted commas, all the other Sahaba kiram for screaming out loudly and shouting and this and that and everything inside there. And he told him that your Lord is neither absent nor is he. He's all hearing, right? So tone down yourself a little bit, right? But Abu Musa al-Ash'ari didn't join them. And he was making dhikr in his heart. Now, who should the Prophet ﷺ should have first chastised? The one reading dhikr or the one keeping silent? Outwardly, you and I, if you saw 20 people making zikr loudly, then one guy is sitting there. Hey, bhai, make zikr, what's wrong with you? The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to me. He said he came to me sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? And in this condition that I was, the sahabi who was doing this was Abdullah bin Qais, and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari narrates this, right? Abdullah bin Qais was making la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah in his heart. The Prophet of Allah came to him. He left everybody else. He came to him. He said, oh, Abdullah bin Qais, say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. The Prophet of Allah intuited what it was in the man's heart. And he said, say it. Say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And the Prophet encouraged him and he told him. He says, right? He says, you know what it is? No. I don't feel like I'm in control. Have you heard this? You know, I'm feeling like I'm not in control. I have no control over anything. So in the back of my mind, I say, but that's the right way to have it. You know, we always talk about freedom of choice. No, we must have freedom of choice. What about the freedom of no choice? What about the freedom of no choice? Aram said, you. You saw the freedom of no choice of babies. It's a pretty Aisha, not sure she gave birth. Allah bless her, make dua for the child. It's a nice baby girl. And some of you all know Aisha. Most of you should know Aisha. She sits here normally. Right? Have you seen the freedom of no choice in children? Have you seen it? Do the children decide what they're going to wear? Mother puts on the clothes. Children decide when they're going to eat? Meh, that's about it. The only two indications that they give. When they're hungry and when they want to clean themselves. Other than that, they're not interested. Everything else, who takes on absolute responsibility for it? The parents? Child? Aram said. You know, go somewhere, carry you and go.